Please join me with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening and welcome to the Hampton Board of Selectmen's meeting for January 9th. We'll start off with a couple of public hearings. The first one is a public hearing pursuant to RSA 33-8A and RSA 40-13-2-AC. The purpose for complying with the provisions of the RSA 38-8A and RSA 40-13-2-ANC is to take testimony from those who wish to be heard concerning the possible issuance of bonds or following or notes for the following. A, $4,242,000 bond for the replacement of the Church Street Force Main. B, $1,100,000 bond for the replacement of the Sewer Main on Lafayette Road from High Street to Winnicott Road, then to Toll Ave. And C, $1 million note for the streets and sidewalk improvements for the Winnicott Road and High Street. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, I would yield to the Public Works Director and Assistant Director for a description of the proposed replacement of the Church Street Sewer Force Main for $4,242,000. That's an estimate.
Okay. Go ahead. Thank you.
For the lack of, or for the audience at home, if I and for the people here, just take a second to encapsulate briefly what we're talking about. Currently, Church Street Force Main goes from the Church Street pump station to this location in the plant. Current wastewater treatment plant for everyone's edification, the water tower is right here on Church Street. So it's two sites over. That's a Eversource electrical substation. So right now we have a ductile iron force main and an AC asbestos cement force line under the marsh. This one was installed in 1967. This one installed in 1987. So that makes them respectfully 29 and 49 years of age. We last year in approximately this location a crack or a hole developed in the pipe the existing steel pipe, the ductile iron pipe that rested against the stone or stones underneath the pipe. Discovered we're 4 weeks short of a year of when it was discovered and was repaired late in March, about March 20th, because we laid a road, a bridge, and a road out to the marsh, actually dug down 7 feet, cut the defect out, and replaced it with a smaller, short section of pipe, not smaller diameter, but same size. Brought it back up to pressure. It's held pressure for several days, and we've used it since then. The major issue is, in a pipe like this, is getting out there to maintain it. We've spoken with a number of people to actually either clean the pipe or inspect the pipe, clean it first. Next impossible to do is just shy of 4,000 feet. The pipe has many, even though it's shown as a straight line, it has a couple of 11 degree bends, being asked to be mic'd. I'll pause for mic.
For those at home, give me a thumbs up if you can hear me from studio land.
Good.
Okay. I was at the point about talking about cleaning it. We haven't regularly cleaned it because to clean the pipe, the length of the cleaning equipment would cause us actually to have to go out there and in two or more locations physically break the pipe to get the cleaning equipment into the pipe. to then clean the pipe, to then actually visually inspect the pipe. Hasn't been done. Hasn't been done ever on the AC line, and it hasn't been done on the ductile iron line. We did have equipment and manpower on staff the day we actually cut into this, but the picture showed that the pipe going this way and coming back as far as the eye could see with lights, the pipe was already one-third full of muck, tidal dirt, if for lack of a better description, some of the bedding stone, because the hole had been open long enough that it had allowed all that material in. The pipe does actually dip down and sag under a number of marsh locations, three other locations. It actually dips down. So it's anticipated that those dips or low points are actually have a lot more material in them. In discussions with the state, because we don't have the capability to get in there on a regular basis, clean and inspect and make sure that these pipes are, if you will, up to standard for working, for performance, the discussion was that we had to find an alternative route. We did look at pushing another pipe under the marsh. We looked at bursting the pipes under the marsh. We looked at a number of things, all of them costing the same as an overland route down along Route 101 and then down Tide Mill Road back to the plant. The big advantage over something like this is I'm requesting cleanouts here, here, and this will be a gravity portion. We would have the ability in the future to clean and maintain the pipe system that we would put under 101. The pipe system that we are going with is a continuously fused together high density polyethylene pipe. Two of them 16 inch in diameter is what was right. Second in command confers. Plus that's what the slide shows. Thank you. By having two of them side by side in the same trench, they're going to be, you know, below the shoulder of the road. And by having observation and clean out manholes, we'll be able to, on a regular basis, probably every other year or every third year, whatever our consultants finally recommend, we'd actually close one line in the off season, jet it to clean it, and then do a visual inspection on it to make sure that it isn't cracking, leaked, or anything of that nature. So with the two of those, this will be something that can be preserved, maintained. Big term that's floated in all of public works is make things sustainable. This option is sustainable. This option is not sustainable, nor is another pipe under the marsh a sustainable out into the future. So the last estimate based upon the drillings that have been done and soil borings and pipe assessment of the existing section of pipe in Tide Mill Road is that we're at $4,242,000, what we announced. With that, that's a quick overview and summation. I could take questions by the board or the public.
Up to you, let people testify.
Yeah, go ahead.
When you get to the
I think they want you to come and use the mic.
Please.
Please.
Most of us know you are, Peter, but...
Pete Tilton, Landing Road. When you get to the Tide Mill Bridge, are you going to go under the water or just go along the bridge and keep it accessible that way, too?
There were three options. Under, attached to the bridge, or beside the bridge, with our own bridge. Discussions with the Department of Transportation, we can't hang off of their bridge. They need to also to make their bridge sustainable. They need to be able to get in there, clean it, inspect it. As you can see, recently in the last couple of weeks, they've actually been doing some work on their bridge on the edge supports. So the other thing that we looked at was the ability to go under. It's actually less expensive if we just build our own bridge. We've worked it out with the DOT. We can cut into and build off of their wing walls that already exist there. We would just have to fabricate our own, i.e. the steel portion, to build our own bridge.
Okay. Will that impinge the passage of boat traffic? Will you be just as high as the current bridge?
Well, we will be no lower than the existing girders, steel girders of that Route 101 bridge.
Okay, thanks.
Yep.
Any other questions from the audience? Seeing none, bring it back to the board. Are there any questions? Oh, sure.
Gary Poole, 4 Lion Street. What happens to all this? What happens to all the pipes underneath the marsh after you've completed this project?
A number of options. One of them is to push in what we call flowable fill, very loose cement, and seal it off. At this point in time, I'd like to just cap it on both ends.
So you're going to dead end each side?
So I'd basically cap it on both ends. Okay. Do nothing with it in the short term. Because if I still don't have my actual operational permit, my 7-year renewal permit from the EPA office out of Boston, I've been here 5 years and we've been waiting for 5 years for the 7-year permit. No, they're just overworked. There's no, please don't take that as a slam on the EPA. Because at some point, if I had to find another discharge point, or another option, I could actually go back and use one of those for treated wastewater. In other words, right now I currently discharge treated wastewater from this location out here to the creek. If for some reason they told me I couldn't use the creek, but I had to, if I could use one of these and let's say bypass and get it out further, it would be foolish for me to throw that asset away at this time. So until I get past that re-permitting stage, I don't want to throw that asset away, but I will cap it and not use it.
Opposite the Church Street side where it ends on the other side of the marsh, is it connected to pipes on that side too? Or does it go into what was
yes, it? Yes, it's connected right here. There's actually a gravity manhole here that it's connected.
What do you intend to do with those pipes? Because they're going to be connected to nothing at this time too, or are you going to attach them to something else?
I just would literally put a plug in them and cap them. For right
so
now.
We're going to have all this underground with nothing being used in them, right?
Right. We just would leave, right now, I'll leave them with the water that they have in there.
Okay. Would they be cleaned out prior to you capping them?
I would probably, I don't want to mislead anyone. I wouldn't make them crystal clean, but I would push through enough water to exchange out all the raw effluent that I would need to treat.
Now, these pipes aren't pressure pipes. They're regular gravity pipes, right?
They are under pressure when they're pumped by the pump station. Okay. But we're talking 5-7 PSI. Okay. It's not what you'd call, it's not 150 PSI.
Not like you'd turn on a hot water feature.
Right. And not like buses. A water line.
Okay. Right. Thank you for your time.
Yep, thank you.
Any other questions from the audience? Questions from the board?
Yeah, I just got a couple of just clarification because I've heard this a number of times. Stuff. If you were to put pipes in today, brand new, would you be allowed to go through the marsh?
Only if I could prove that I could clean them and inspect them on an annual basis. Mm-hmm. And so the answer is no.
Yeah. And you would classify the marsh as sensitive environment, yes?
Oh, definitely.
Definitely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
The permitting environment that in 87 that allowed us to go into the marsh does not exist today. I'd basically have to prove to them that going down 101 and Tide Mill Road was infeasible, i.e., tanker traffic needed to use that route. That is proven to be a possible solution, so this would prove to be an impossible or unfeasible or unacceptable solution.
And if we were to do nothing and have another leak, they would say to us, we knew that there was the probability of another leak. And
yes, you can't, when you know you have bad tires in your car and you've already had one flat, you can't ignore the situation that you may have another flat. I know other people have alluded to there would be fines. That comes off as threatening. The real issue here is, and we all faced this a year ago when we had the release of the untreated, is it made the water quality in the Tidal Mill Creek, the clam beds, Hampton Harbor suffer. I wouldn't want the town to be get a bad reputation for uncontrolled effluent discharges when we knew we could have done something about it, because our reputation is at risk.
And especially when we're doing so much with coastal hazard and everything else. I mean, everything today is geared towards
it. It's becoming much more, it's a much more sensitive, yeah. Every day in the news we talk about coastal rise, environmental damage, oil spills around the world. This is a much more sensitive world than it was in 87 when we did this. So, yeah, we need to be more aware of our immediate surroundings and take responsibility for it.
Thank you.
Bill? Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Director, Assistant Director. Nice presentation for all the obvious reasons and key strategic and tactical reasons for the town, the business community, and the reputation of the beach, and state revenue. I support the project. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Very good. Do we need to vote on each one of these?
You can take them up collectively at the end, or you may vote on them as you do them.
Why don't we just take them up all at the end?
All right.
Okay. Move on with B.
What do you want to show? You want to show the other?
Yeah, the other.
This guy? Help improve the experience.
There's Depot City on this.
One of the other lifebloods in the town is the Lafayette Road sewer main. Give you an idea of what we're looking at here. This is the High Street and Lafayette Road intersection. This would be the Winnicunnet Road, Lafayette Road intersection. We have PVC pipe, the more current, durable pipe, where you see the green sewer line. So coming down from High Street, we have PVC sewer right into that location. Also, we have, this is the Exeter Road Interceptor. That's PVC pipe. But you can see around town, there are a number of sections where we still have vitrified clay pipe. This is 1970s to 1980s technology. It literally is clay that's been cast in the shape of a pipe, baked, hardened. Depending on the size, you can have a joint every 4 feet, every 6 feet, 5 feet. And they're not joints like we think of today where if anybody's ever glued two pieces of PVC pipe together, it fuses tight. This stuff does not fuse tight. It basically has a joint that can move, expand, contract in a number of locations. Going back in to 1967, this section of pipe, which by the way was built in 1934, was inspected visually in 1967, and then it was deemed as having many structural cracks eligible and should be replaced. 1967. 1989, it's inspected again. In approximately this location, a portion of the pipe is missing, meaning when the camera goes down, there's no top section and there's no right section. Matter of fact, we can cant the camera a little bit to the right and we see nothing. We don't see dirt, we just see a hole. So Jen's brought up on the screen, this is a typical structural crack. This would be the center of the pipe. Here's a structural crack across the top. These are 1989s. And this is the hole that I just was mentioning when we tilt the camera to the right. This whole section of piece of pipe, probably is as big as my hand, is missing, along with the top piece is missing. The good thing is, over the years that it's been there, it's actually made its own wall with the outside soil. So the effluent's still flowing through. But after we suffered the March force main break, in February, about, I think it was late February, February 22nd. And let's see if I can position myself, building. Right. And approximately this area here, where this manhole is, we actually had a release of floatable grease. We call it fog. It's made up of floatables, organics, and grease. It congeals together. It just looks like a slug of fat. It literally lifted up the manhole cover, floated it off, and raw effluent ran down the street at 8 o'clock in the morning. We went in, cleaned it out as best we could, but we have a piece of equipment called a jet truck. It's a fire size hose with a nozzle on the end of it, and it literally puts out a jet of water at 2,000 PSI. We don't put that jet in this particular sewer PVC clay pipe line to clean it, because we're afraid at 2,000 PSI it'll open those cracks up and take more sections of the pipe away. Because it's in a tenuous situation, we don't want to get in there and destroy it. So we jet above it, we jet below it, but we never jet in that area. I think the situation that occurred a year ago in February when that sewer overflow occurred was the warning that we needed to do something. Where the two force mains are the lifeblood, if you will, of the beach community to get the effluent away, this is the lifeblood of all the downtown area, because it literally carries all the sewer from the Northampton line, heading south through this direction and then this way to the plant. It ends up going down Park Ave over to the plant. So this is one of the two major arteries, if you will, in town. If this one shuts down for a period of time, everyone in the town area, the village district, is impacted directly. So that's why we're seeking to get this one also replaced. The other project, this project, have both been put on the state's revolving fund list. They are both eligible for state-supported funding for these type projects, meaning many year bond year, like a bond over several years to pay it back at a very low interest rate. So they both qualify for that. In the future, I believe the $1.1 million estimate does take it all the way down. This is galley hatch. It takes it all the way to this manhole. And to the east, it takes it all the way to this manhole. This is where the Baptist Church is. So in the future, we'd have to do Toll Ave and the rest of this. But High Street, these are all other vitrified clay pipes that we'd have to do at some other point in time. But for right now, this is the most important one. Take question.
Any questions from the audience? Seeing none, I'll bring it back to the board.
So is it safe to say that from the way Public Works stands, that you have three main arteries for the town of Hampton that you are unable to maintain and sustain as one should be able to? Meaning getting in, doing maintenance, performing, looking, putting cameras down there, figuring out what's going on. Because you know you can't clean the marsh pipe.
Right.
Because 7 feet under the marsh and it's just not a straight line. But it sounds like with the Lafayette pipe that you can't really clean that either.
Due to its frail condition.
Right. So we are dealing with three main wastewater pipes.
It's like a patient that wouldn't withstand the operation.
Right. That we can't. Right. We can't clean.
Right. Those are the three. The rest of them we are in better shape. We do maintain them. But yes, this is because of this one's critical nature. We don't get in and use all the methods that we have. If we roto-rooted this one, we don't think we'd have anything left to roto-rooter at the end of the day. So.
All right. Thank you. Jim?
And I mean, this is not a case of if, it's a case of when.
Right.
That's the case. And if you think about the economic impact of that ever happening would be pretty, would be more than substantial.
Right.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Again, thank you, Director, Assistant Director, and again, for all the obvious reasons, fully support the project. Thank you.
Okay. The last one is C.
If I can, Mr. Chairman, we would request that the board remove this warrant article. The State Department of Transportation notified us officially today in writing that the $800,000 grant was not awarded to the town. So if this article were passed, there would be no grant money coming back. The town would have to absorb $1 million in total. And our recommendation is that this be removed from the warrant at this time.
Okay. So, I need a motion.
So moved.
Second. Wow, that's fast. Motion to accept A and B and take C off. Is that my motion? Is okay. So I have a motion, second. All those in favor? Unanimous. Okay. Public hearing. RSA 31:95B3A. I'm just going to read the first part of this because the rest of it has been printed. Everybody can see it. There are many grants on here. If somebody really wants to read it, I'm just going to read the first part of it. For the purpose of complying with the provisions of RSA 31:95B3A, for the following: to apply and accept and expend unanticipated monies in the amount of $10,000 or more from the following in 2017. And the rest of them have all written there.
We make a motion that we accept
as
printed. As printed, and maybe you should read it all. No. First you want to hear from the public.
You want to get public input.
Is there anybody here from the public that wants to speak on this? Anybody from the public? Seeing none, anybody on the board? Need a motion to...
I make a motion that, pursuant to RSA A31:95-B, Roman numeral 3A, that we accept.
Motion, second. All those in favor? Unanimous. So now the public hearings are now closed. Have public comment period. Anybody from the public would like to speak? Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Charlie Preston, 47 Glade Path. I was curious if it was possible in the community announcement section, you know, early in the month, the end of the month, if we could make it a regular thing to let people know about the state parks plates, because a lot of people still aren't familiar with it. And you have to do it when you register your car. You pay $85, but you're going to be able to park down the beach. This started September 15th. So anybody that registers their car in the month of January pays the $85. They'll pick up 20 days in April, 20 in May, 10 in June, 10 in September, and 20 in October. It's a great thing for people to go to the beach, whether they're doing business down there. It'll help all the businesses. But if we could let everybody know each month, because there's a lot of people that still aren't familiar with it, it's new, the state hasn't done a very good job of promoting it, so I think we can do it for our businesses. I'd appreciate it if we could try to put it in as a regular thing at the beginning and the end of each month to get people, because they have to do it when they register. I wanted to touch briefly on, I saw something in here about legislation, and I was reading in the paper about a local newspaper, and I use that term liberally, with newspapers today. And it talked about, you know, us leasing the state park and there possibly legislation there. And personally, I think establishing a commission, I say at what cost? You know, if it costs a dime, I'm against it. I personally think it's an exercise in futility. The state parks generated $1.8 million in 2015 in parking revenues. But the state parks down there accept cash, credit, debit. On our own Ashworth Ave, it's cash. If you have a credit card, they send you the casino ATM. If this is going to be Hampton's policy, then maybe we should put in our own ATM. I question why we even plow the Ashworth Ave lot. This week during a snowstorm, that lot was plowed but locked. That I don't understand. If we're going to have it locked, just don't even bother plow it. I worked on bathrooms, parking meters, and state park plates, and have been very successful in all efforts. Sometimes it takes a little longer than it should. My agenda is simple. It's user-friendly. In my opinion, Hampton is not even user-friendly to its own residents at the Ashworth Ave lot. Until such time as we can fix our own issues, let's not take on more. When I say that, I'm talking about something as simple as an exit on Brown Ave. I came before this board before about talking about an entrance and exit, and then there was some resistance from people running it. So let's take some baby steps. Let's get an exit on Brown Ave. You've got a master plan that's been done. You have a parking and transportation study that's been done, and you're trying to alleviate traffic. And here we are, by sending them out of our lot on Ashworth Ave, making them go up G Street and back to go north. And just by opening the exit on Brown Ave, makes it simple for our residents. We got a long way to go to becoming user-friendly to the taxpayers and residents, but let's get on it. Until such time, until we get our own house in order, let's not buy another house. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Charlie. Anybody else from the audience would like to speak? Yes, ma'am.
Helena Barthel, 33 Dover Avenue. Thank you for your time. I had written a letter to the Board of Selectmen several weeks ago, but I waited to come until after I knew that I had the required number of signatures to get a petition on the warrant articles that will be voted on, asking for a deed restriction to be removed. We just bought the land, very joyously and happy about that, in November for the two lots that we live on 33 Dover Avenue and our rental property 35 Dover Avenue. But there was a restriction in the lease that also carried onto the deed that we cannot sell the properties separately. They must stay under the same ownership. And I personally would like to just retire and get out of the rental business and sell one and live in the other. And we are aware that condominiumizing is an option if the warrant article fails, but I would prefer the cleaner separation of just being able to sell them separately. I don't presume to tell you why the deed restriction is there. I would imagine it's because of the amount of frontage. There's no frontage for 35. And that's why our warrant article says it's upon the condition that we get a deeded right of access for each of the properties, which we are pursuing, looking into an easement for a right-of-way, you know, a lot line adjustment. But I've talked to several people about that. Because of the timing where we had to get on the ballot in March. So I just wanted to respectfully ask the board's approval, because I think that would help it pass. So thank you.
Very good. Just remember, when it comes up to deliberative session, that you should also be there, because that's people will ask questions.
Yes.
And you'll have an opportunity to speak about it again.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Anybody else? Pete?
Just kind of a point of order. I've been to public hearings and they do them various ways. Sometimes they'll ask for questions and then comment. Sometimes they combine them. You asked for questions earlier and I responded thinking there was going to be comments. I could see the four of you were all pointed in the right direction, so I didn't need to bring it up and fan the flames. But just make it clear to people, you know, if they want to just come up and say yay or nay and why. I mean, because I just assumed there was going to be a comment period on the public hearing.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions from the public? Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Now, first of all, I'm not a resident of Hampton, so am I allowed to speak during public?
What are you here for?
Well, it's not anything on the agenda. It's something that I reached out to some members of the Board of Selectmen before, and I want to...
Are you the person that called me on the phone?
I am, yes.
Yeah, I'll tell you, nobody's been briefed on it. That was a shot in the dark. You called me unsolicited with no preparation, and I am not prepared to talk about the subject of your comments tonight. Thank you. You're the UNH student, correct?
Yes, I am.
Thank you, sir.
All right, thank you. Okay. Announcements, community calendar.
Virginia. Nothing, Mr. Chairman.
Nothing, except it's cold out.
It is cold out.
Nothing, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you. And next is the release of the consent agenda, which is a release of a welfare lien at 200 Landing Road, Unit 76.
I'll move the consent agenda.
I'll second it.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Approval of the minutes of December 12th and December 19th.
I'll make the motion.
Do them separately because I was absent from the 19th.
All right.
I'll have to abstain on that.
We'll do them. Do December 12th motion.
Motion to approve December 12th.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Motion to approve December 19th.
Second. Phil?
Yes, sir. Yep.
All those in favor? 3-1 abstention. Okay. Appointments. Representative Phil Bean, legislation.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Can we have the finance director, the town assessor, and Attorney Giraud sit at the table? If I could ask permission to step off.
Sure.
That's some legislative efforts. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, thank you, board members, and just wanted to go forward with some of the legislative agenda that has been brought forward in this session from the Hampton delegation and co-sponsorship from some adjoining towns. Mr. Chinker is going to speak out, as he has in the past, about three legislative bills that have cost the town of Hampton over $1 million. The finance director will speak about some of the capabilities we could have used. With that money, we've heard tonight $5 million just on public works initiatives alone. I'll speak to a couple of issues, and then Mr. Giraud will speak specifically about a public utilities issue for legislation. Mr. Tinker.
Thank you. Tonight, I want to speak on three RSAs that were acted on in Hampton. The first one, 79E, which is the community tax relief incentive. That's for... revitalizing rundown buildings or improving buildings or building on vacant parcels that had lost the buildings from natural disasters or fires, things like that. There was one granted in 2014 that runs for 5 years through the 2018 tax year. The second one is 72-8A, which has to do with the taxation of utility poles and conduit owned by telecommunication companies. In 2011, they became taxable under that RSA. In 2016, it was determined that the DRA would set values on those poles and conduit, or the portion of pole that the telecommunication company owns. So that actually will begin this April 2017. They will have control over the formulas used to value poles and conduit. The third one is 7212A, which has to do with the pollution control exemption for utility companies, more specifically Seabrook Power Plant for Hampton's portion that runs through the Hampton River. When we look at those three broken out over a 10-year period, we determined the tax effect for those 10 years of approximately $1.8 million. To look at it another way, it's about $9.6, almost $10 million in assessed value per year. And over a 10-year period, of course, we're looking at about $96 million worth of assessment if you look at it as a whole over those 10 years. Those three, again, RSAs have resulted in that effect for Hampton and Hampton alone. So statewide, it's a large thing, but for Hampton, those are the numbers that we determined or estimated over a 10-year period through 2026.
Thank you. And Chris, do you want to speak about the implications of that?
When we looked at the state values for utilities compared to the town and calculated the estimated tax rate according to those new values, losing, I believe it was $29,931. The tax rate jumps from 6.08 to 16.22 for 16. So you're talking an increase of 14 cents in your tax rate, and that will continue to compound each year. We also did a rough estimate of a bond totaling the $1,851,000. I used the 4.25%, which is the rate that I just got from the bond bank in regards to the bonds that we had on the article, and you're looking at $3,070,346. So it's a lot of money over time. So that's why I have the money.
And your point is with finance costs, it costs that much more?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, yes. Great. With financing, yes, because there's principal and interest.
So that 1.8 that the
turns into three. Assessor
turns into over $3 million. You see that almost fully funds the project at the beach with the force main. You see that it's three times as much as the infrastructure needs in Hampton here. There's a member of that general court now, and thank you if you voted for me. And right off the bat, 1198 was a bill that was up there, and we all testified up there and went up there. And it's a first piece of legislation is to repeal that. It's fiscal notes. And how that reads when this legislation, and Jim is a former legislator, Rusty was up there for 10 years. And what accompanied this, and if you just heard the stark testimony of finance and the tax assessor, this is how the bills are gilded. This is how the pump is primed. This legislation, and we were up there speaking about it, the Department of Revenue and the New Hampshire Municipal Association state the bill is introduced may have an indeterminable impact on local expenditures in fiscal year 2016 and each year thereafter. There will be no fiscal impact on state, county, and local revenue to state and county expenditures. Ed, how long did it take you to calculate what it's eventually going to cost us, $3.8 million?
Within a day.
Within a day.
Sure.
And yep. Christy, how long did it take you to tabulate what you just gave us?
Less than a day.
Less than a day. So this is just one tax assessing. As we know, this is just the municipal side of the house. There's also the school side of the house. This is tens and tens and tens of millions of dollars that legislators are taking from the local tax base. It puts the downshifting of cost in the rear closet of concern because legislators are legislating a destruction of local taxpayers, and citizens are not getting heard. And again, the pump is getting greased with a lack of integrity and a lack of accuracy with the fiscal notes. The bill, and we will be meeting tomorrow afternoon or this week with the New Hampshire Municipal Association, Randy Cushing, and other interested legislators, is to bring that issue to the fore, to publicize that, to work with the New Hampshire Municipal Association. So hard-earning taxpayers in the town of Hampton aren't short of $3.8 million by business interest and corporate interest in Concord. If you go and get a car, you've got to have truth in lending. If you're at a bank, you'll hear at the end of a commercial, the truth in lending. We need truth in legislation. So that's the foundation going forward of a piece of legislation that's being brought forth by the Seacoast delegation. Additionally, Ed spoke about 7212, 7274, 1198, as I call it, 79A, $3.8 million. We have introduced legislation to repeal those three laws because they're stealing money from local taxpayers. And it's a huge amount of money. So that's how that looks. Relative to the meals and rooms tax in 2012, there was an inquiry to the delegation. It's tough to get that done, but of course, in the world of mega data today, we know Hampton only gets back $600,000 or $700,000, which is an infinitesimal amount for what we contribute. There are other Seacoast communities that are interested in this data, so we can have a more integrity-based, transparent discussion in Concord about what it costs us for operations, what it costs for the police department, what it costs for our fire to support these revenue camps in the state, and just particularly in Hampton, where it would approach at a ballpark figure, but fairly accurately, if not more, $200 million in revenue that's taken out of this town that we police, that we fire, that we protect. So that's how that looks. We have a bill in to study simply the state park, and if Mr. Preston is speaking, that it's to execute a transition immediately. The cart is before the horse on that. There is a Chapter 216J. It's the Hampton Beach Area Commission. What this legislation, sponsored by the delegation, is simply to make a simple change to this governing document from Mr. Nyhan, Commissioner Nyhan's commission, that allows for the study, as Mr. Preston has indicated, and these things take time, a study by both the town with state representatives that the commission, the very powerful commission, is already established. And we go ahead and we look at the feasibility and perhaps the reasons we might want to do that. On the DRED website, there is a guiding principle for leases. We meet or exceed all the overarching principles. We meet or exceed all the reasons to lease. We meet or exceed guiding principles for leasing. We meet or exceed the entire document. Precedent is already established in Jericho. Precedent is already established in Sunapee. Interestingly, we speak about revenue. The town of Newbury, since Sunapee went private, has received $2.3 million in tax revenue. We're not even talking about the operations side. Goshen, another town, has received a lesser amount. The town of Goshen will also see an increase in tax revenue of around $100,000 a year. So there's newfound money by exploring these different options. The lease and operating agreement with Sunapee Mountain is an interesting document. I commend everybody to read it. You can go to the state parks website and find it with a simple search. The initial lease was a 20-year lease for $150,000 a year. We're talking about a small sliver of the beach that the town of Hampton formerly owned. The folks from Okemo lease 850 acres with another addition for development up in that area for $150,000 a year, plus 3% of the gross. So again, this just opens the discussion. The public speaker, Mr. Preston, talked about the revenue that the state gets from the parking. Well, they simply slide that off. They kick back in $200,000 for a capital reserve for the seawall, but they go ahead and bond that when they do it with borrowed money, and it supports the rest of the park system, and none of it comes back here. So a study of the DRED parks income statements, I commend that to anybody to do a research on it. And again, the financial report. So that's where we're at. That's the first blast out of the gates up there. Great people up there, hardworking people up there. As you know, Mr. Bridle, with 10 years of service, and Jim, as you know, is a one-term legislator up there. And now we go to Mr. Giraldo, and he's going to specifically speak about a utilities issue.
Yeah. With the board's permission, I have drafted several bills for Representative Bean to present. One of them had to do with the commission, the rules of the legislature as to the reporting of collection of taxes, and that speaks entirely to the revenues at the beach on rooms and meals. One of those bills requires that the source of the revenue be reported on the returns where it is not now being reported, such as to identify each municipality by way of the location of the revenue so that that can be tracked and monitored. At this point, that's not being done. So whenever you ask the revenue, what is the source of the rooms and meals, they say, well, we can't tell. This bill would require the sources to be reported in such a way that we can tell. Another bill that's been, as Mr. Bean mentioned, Representative Bean, the fiscal impact of the bill, such as the bill HB 1198, was reported as indeterminate. The bill that's been presented here would say that no fiscal impact note shall indicate that fiscal impact is indeterminate or the like, just because of the large number of affected entities or individuals. It forces
the drafters of these fiscal impact notes to be precise and to be upfront so that everyone knows what the impact, the dramatic impact such as has to do with those polls, what that is. And as has been demonstrated, this can readily be determined with just a short amount of time. It doesn't have to be listed as indeterminate and therefore hidden. The third an example that I've specifically been asked also to address is the fact that, as we have seen, in order for the infrastructure of utilities to be taxed, infrastructure that's located on rights of way, there needs to be a written agreement in place that indicates that those are to be taxed. That written agreement comes in several different ways. One way is when the planning board approves a subdivision which has underground utilities. That represents the same thing as approving a pole license. The town has the ability, and we have done so, to amend all of those licenses that had been granted in the past to include the language that requires taxation. Another form is when the selectmen are asked to approve pole licenses. Those pole licenses today all include the language allowing for taxation. The state, when it licenses poles on its property, also includes that language of taxation. This fall, we come to a different situation before the Public Utilities Commission, where they were asked by Fairpoint to license some 220 crossings of public waters or public lands. And they were asked to include in any such licenses this same taxing language, and the Public Utilities Commission refused because they claimed they did not have the authority from the legislature to add this taxing language. This bill supplements their authority and directs them to include that language. Otherwise, in at least those 200 plus situations, that's not going to be taxable by the municipalities in which that property is located. And it should be.
Thank you, Esquire. And Mr. Chairman, the town is, of course, very well-suited and well-benefited from your leadership, Mr. Welch's leadership, and having two former legislators on the board here with Regina and Rick. And Mr. Welch, the exceptional capabilities of your staff at the Command Element Finance, Mr. Giraldo drafting the legislation, and they're very, very professional. There's moves underfoot for the assessing function to be taken more strongly held in Concord. That'll be another bone of contention. But there is a battle to be fought up there that's integrity-based, that is more transparent, and as we can see, on just three simple laws, it will cost over time $3.8 million, which is a significant chunk of the vast cost that Public Works presented here tonight, and that Hampton residents and Hampton business owners, Hampton taxpayers will have to pony up. Gentlemen, young lady, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have questions already?
Yeah. Did you want questions?
Questions?
Gosh. First of all, where's the rest of the legislation? Were they invited? The rest of our delegation?
They're coming. They're going to be invited for the 23rd.
They're in the 23rd?
Yeah.
23rd. Okay.
We had such a long meeting tonight.
We have to make sure that we're doing this as a group, right? Cooperatively. Right. Very important, because one person in a house of 400.
Well, as we said, Mr. Selectman and former rep, that in my remarks, it is from the delegation.
Okay.
And Rainey, Cushing, and I are working on some other bills as well that are coming up. But this is a numbers game. This is simply a matter of votes. These bills have not been introduced before. They quite simply haven't. And I had a email out on the Meals and Rooms in 2012. And this delegation here never got back. So it hasn't been in the game, and it hasn't brought any bills forward like this. And there was some discouragement, but it hasn't been done, and now it's getting done. And then that's the first step. The second step is to get the majority of votes, and more importantly, that this Concord area, with lobbyists and all the good functions they do provide up there, that these bills are not killed in committee, because that's what happens. These bills are killed in committee, and these voices aren't heard, and it's going on.
Right. The other thing I wanted to say was 78, 79E, that was at the request of Hampton, wasn't it, that that bill was initially introduced?
I believe so.
Was at the request of Hampton. And initially that was introduced in order to economic development. For, I mean, it might have been used improperly, but the bill itself initially was a fairly good bill.
It was actually, and I was on the board, and I was the one member that voted against it. It was specifically stated in the bill for affordable housing. The housing that was granted the exemption of $175,000 went for over $400 a square foot. So I know you live at the beach, but that's still pretty pricey.
Right, right. And I'm also not going to let you off the hook that the last couple of delegations have worked diligently for the rooms and meals tax to get them changed. Maybe not the exact same bill, but they have worked diligently to do it, and we all know that. So I just want to make that clear and work with the other people up there.
Thank you, brother.
You're right. Okay.
Any other questions? Very good. Thank you.
Thanks,
guys.
Okay.
Next one is Chief Soyo, the departmental update.
Report. I apologize for not having that to you earlier, but I'm not all the
issue. That's great. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
Mr. Chairman, historically in January, I give a yearly update as opposed to that last quarter because it is our slowest quarter of the year. So, staffing levels again, full-time 34. In February, Officer Tim Hamlin was promoted to the rank of Sergeant. Sergeant Hamlin has served the department since 1996. In his time with the department, Sergeant Hamlin has been tasked the variety of assignments to include patrol, mounted patrol, use of force instructor, team leader with the Seam Coast Response Team, and he's currently leading a shift now in his assignment as sergeant. In April, Officer Justin Goudreau graduated from the 169th New Hampshire Police Academy. Officer Goudreau resides in Manchester, New Hampshire, and then started his career with the department as a part-time officer in 2015. Officers Jason Jackson, Robert Kenyon, and Vitaly Sorokins were assigned as summer corporals, successfully filling those positions from June until September. On September 16th, Deputy Chief Hobbs graduated from the 265th session of the FBI National Academy. The FBINA is a 10-week program which provides coursework on intelligence theory, terrorism, terrorist mindsets, management science, law, behavioral science, law enforcement communications, forensic science services to improve the administration of justice in police departments and agencies at home and abroad to raise law enforcement standards, knowledge, and cooperation worldwide. While Deputy Chief Hobbs was attending the FBI National Academy, Officer Tim Galvin was assigned as an adjutant to assist with the scheduling and additional administrative duties. Officer Shannon Feely was assigned as the assistant prosecutor in October. We still have that one officer that's out due to duty-related injuries. That is being worked out between workman's comp and the retirement system. We're either going to see a February 1st or most likely a March 1st retirement date set for that. We did begin the process of interviewing candidates to fill that position as soon as it becomes vacant. Part-time staffing, we have 33 sworn on the roster right now, but obviously if we wind up hiring one, that'll deplete. And I have intentions from two or three other officers that are going to be departing for other agencies here very, very soon. The department began the season with 31 working part-time officers with 2 on leave of absence. The number remained consistent throughout the summer and is held steady. On November 18th, Hampton PD had 4 new officer recruits graduate from the 272nd New Hampshire Part-Time Academy. The department has 5 new officer recruits tentatively scheduled to attend the 273rd Academy beginning in February. So if all successfully get through the training, that'll bring us 9 new officers for the summer 2017. Department operations, 2016 was an active year for the department. Started the summer with the 13 part-time officers, 10 of those being new to the department. Recruitment and retention continue to be areas of focus and concern for the department and for law enforcement across the country. Each year it takes extraordinary efforts by our training cadre to prepare our special part-time officers for the summer beach operation. Our supervisory personnel did an outstanding job leading and mentoring a team that provided for a safe and enjoyable summer season. Tragically, 9 overdose deaths were investigated in Hampton in 2016. Patrol Division and the Criminal Investigative Division continue to work diligently with our local, state, and federal partners to combat the opioid epidemic the region has experienced. The department continues to have an officer assigned to the Regional Federal Task Force to help combat the issue. In December, the department joined with the Portsmouth Police Department and the Greenland Police Department to form a Seacoast Region High-Intensity Drug Intervention Team utilizing grant funds from the New Hampshire Department of Safety Law Enforcement Opioid Abuse Reduction Initiative. We've already experienced some good results with that just in the month that we've had it up and running. After experiencing the large crowds early in the summer season, the decision was made to bring an experienced officer from other municipalities to augment our staffing levels. This has proven to be very helpful in maintaining our order and providing for good traffic flow through the beach area. Special thanks to the New Hampshire State Police, the Rockingham County Sheriff's Department, University of New Hampshire Police Department, Epping, Exeter, and Greenland Police Departments, who all provided personnel and equipment to assist during our busy summer season. Also, I'd like to thank the Seabrook Police Department for the continued cooperation and coordination of traffic control along the Ocean Boulevard corridor. Department also worked closely with the New Hampshire Liquor Enforcement Bureau, conducting compliance checks and coordinating efforts to reduce the level of overservice and enforcement of underage drinking laws. Just a special note of thanks to each of these agencies for the continued support and cooperation. Next page is the activity levels compared to 15 to 16. I'll go through those very quickly. Calls for service were up 5%. Motor vehicle stops were up 27%. Arrests were up 10%. DWI is up 14%. Drug offenses were down 4%. Incidents reported down 12%. Offenses total, when we make an arrest, there could be multiple offenses. It may not just be one charge, so that's what that number is. That's up 10%. Felonies are up 21%. Parking tickets were up 5%. And traffic accidents were down 2%. The last several pages of the package I gave you are those state analysis, just the activity that we experienced on those state sites. And there's obviously, if you want more detailed, we can break down actually what those arrests and type of incidents before if we needed that. Just a couple other items before we entertain any questions. I did want to highlight the recruiting issues. We are testing year-round. We do run two tests now. Our next test will be in April 1st. And then the test after that is in October. Anybody interested in trying to become a police officer with the Hampton Police Department, you can go to hamptonpd.com and you can file your application in electronically. We are also happily working towards bringing the police academy back to Hampton PD. We had a meeting on Monday with academy staff, and we're trying to find a way to get that up and running again so we can host in Hampton and simulcast it out of Concord like we did in the past. The budget situation seems to have been rectified, and hopefully we can get that up and running for the February Academy. That's what the goal is. And I would like to announce that if you also go to our website, we do have an open full-time dispatch position. Dan Nersessian, who has been with the department for a long time, announced his retirement. He'll be getting done here the middle of this month with an effective retirement of February 1st. So we wish Dan the best. He's a good guy, did a good job for us, but he's moving on, and we are in accepting applications at this time to replace his position, and we also have part-time dispatch positions available. And if I could at this particular time, if I could throw out there also, we're coming up on our next major event, which is the special New Hampshire Penguin Plunge. We have the high school plunge on February 4th and the Penguin Plunge on February 5th. And we're going to be looking for permission from the board to do the normal routing of traffic, diverting traffic down H Street onto Ashworth Ave from Ocean Boulevard, north along Ashworth Ave to D Street and back up. Okay. And I'll take any questions.
Regina.
No questions, Chief. Thank you very much for the report. And once again, thank you for keeping our town safe very much.
Yeah, it's nice to see drug offenses down 4%. It was terrible to see in the paper that New Hampshire's number one in drug fatalities in the nation, is it?
Per capita, we are number one for opiate addiction and overdose cases. That is correct.
You know, and hopefully the new governor, you know, he said it's going to be one of his priorities, and hopefully he follows through on the priorities, and we keep doing the good work you guys are doing and the good work in the state and get those drug offenses down. DWI is up 14%. Is that because we're more vigilant?
I believe it's a combination of things. I believe there's been a greater focus on motor vehicle. You'll see that the motor vehicle is up, what, I think, 27%. I think that has, motor vehicle activity has a lot to do with other numbers that you look at. I think that's why when you become proactive, you knock other numbers down, you'll notice that the total number of incidents is down, drug offenses down. I think that has something to do with being proactive as opposed to waiting for things to happen and then responding to them. When we have the staffing, and it's one of the reasons why I wanted to bring in the officers from the other agencies, we can go out and be proactive. You think of the high, you know, it's good to see that the grants were accepted tonight, because we do have a number of grants that are coming our way through New Hampshire Highway Safety. I'll be coming in with some other grants from Homeland Security and through the Justice Department. Those grants are essential for us to go out and get officers out targeting specific things that are troubling in this community. If we don't have those, unlikely that we'd be able to fund those. If we don't have the ability to bring in help from the state police, the sheriff's department, liquor enforcement, and then those other municipal agencies and UNH, we just wouldn't be able to do those things. We'd be kind of waiting for things to happen, and that's really not an effective way to police a community like Hampton.
Great. The one other question I had, how much staff would you need in the summer, part-time staff, to not have to go out to the outside agencies?
I would, with the activity we experience on the weekends and the traffic that we experience, we would have to be north of 50 part-time officers.
Would that be cheaper than going to the outside? And I know you have the recruitment problem to get them in training.
That's a very subjective question.
Yeah.
I would say right now that would be very hard for us to accomplish, because you have to also remember, when we have that many people that are that inexperienced, you can't put, you know, with the old saying was, we never would put two new people together. You'd always have an experienced person to walk with a new person. That just isn't the way we are now. I mean, when you look at the part-time ranks, it's about 10 to 12 folks with a lot of experience. I have one guy left from the class of 2012. The next junior person is the class of 2003. I don't have that middle class of experience. I have very experienced, and I have very inexperienced. I don't have that middle group anymore. When you look at what we have, they come in for a summer or two, and either we scoop them up, or Manchester, Nashua, Derry, Salem, say you name the organization, we have officers that started their career here, and they move on to a full-time position. So in order to get to that, it's going to take years for us to get that back there, and that's just a lot of money and a lot of training and a lot of retention for a part-time job, and I don't see that in the foreseeable future.
Thank you.
Cool.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Chief.
Good evening.
I think it's safe to congratulate you on your summer 2016. You never want to jinx anybody, so congratulations. Well done. Amen. Amen. And I can't tell you how strongly the board and the community supports your concept of operations with what has become a more problematic and challenging career profession as a uniformed police officer in this country. And it's a dangerous profession. It's a profession that is a calling for you and your men and women, and they've done a magnificent job. Your tenure is both the deputy chief and now the chief, and tutoring and bringing along your XO, Mr. Hobbs, Deputy Chief Hobbs, and you're a graduate of the FBI Academy. Mr. Hobbs is your XO, and your men do such a great job. For those that stood the mid-watch or the watch over the holidays, a special thanks from the board. I'm sure the board will be doing some type of plaque or dedication for Mr. Nersessian. Congratulations to him, a fine Hampton family with decades and decades and decades of public service and a wonderful family. Your liaison with other communities, your execution in terms of developing those horizontal relationships, and your CERT leadership, you're preeminent in the Seacoast, and if not throughout the entire state of New Hampshire. You're liaison with mass agencies, federal agencies, and the state police, Department of Safety. Extraordinary, and you carry on the highest of traditions and the highest of performance. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Do you need to come back to us for the Special Olympics?
Yes.
I think we could just do that right now, if that would be okay with you. It's nothing has changed. It's the same footprint that we've always used. It'll be H Street to D Street. We'll be diverting traffic, shutting down Ocean Boulevard for that day. open it back up around 2 or 3 o'clock after that the high school plunge is done, and then we just do it all over again on Sunday.
Make a motion that we go along with the chief's recommendation.
Second by Regina. All those in favor? Unanimous. Saves your trip coming back.
Thank you very much.
All right. Next one up is Mary Louise Wolseley, chairman of the Hampton Municipal Budget Committee.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Perhaps Ms. Representative Bean would consider introducing legislation to test the air in Concord for hallucinogens that trigger the taxing reflex. It might be something in the air up there.
It's in the water.
I think actually we have a couple of painless solutions to what we were discussing at the budget meeting the other night. The first one, first consideration is that obviously the manager has the authority to sign the manifest to authorize the finance office to pay the bills. So I don't think that is in any way a point at issue. I will say that I went to the finance office, and I admit that I don't hire attorneys all the time. And the finance office was very gracious and helped me out with the cover sheet, with whatever you fill out to ask to get a payment through. And they were very kind and said they would give it to the manager. I believe Attorney Gerald and Attorney Gould have gotten together and at least resolved the retainer billing. What I wanted to share with you related to this, the minutes of October 30th, 2012 of the Budget Committee, Eileen Latimer was the chairman and I was the vice chairman. On page 4 of those minutes, we were talking with Jamie Steffen, who was then the town planner. And he was asked, I asked why nothing was budgeted for the planning board by way of legal expenses. And Jamie Steffen said they were looking for cuts, so they cut the legal line and the staff development line in that particular budget for 2013. Chairman Latimer compared the planning board budget to the budget committee budget, and she said that the budget committee does not have access to legal counsel in certain cases, and that's why money has been included for that in its budget. Then you go over to page 5, and Attorney Gerald was present at that meeting, and this is verbatim. Mark said, if the budget committee needs legal counsel and there is any conflict, that he would call in outside counsel and charge it to the legal budget. Eileen Latimer said, if the budget committee does have access, then the line can be removed from the budget committee budget, as it was for the planning board. I said that I would strongly suggest that the budget committee, planning and zoning, keep a line for legal in their budgets, as they would need Board of Selectmen approval to have the attorney Gerald call in outside counsel. 12 voted in favor of getting rid of the budget line in the 2013 budget, and I was the only one opposed. I think the point at issue here, and we were told that we had to get permission from you as a board in order to hire counsel and to expend money out of the budget committee's budget. Attorney Gerald addressed the matter of using the outside counsel section of the legal account to help provide counsel in the case where he has a conflict or he can't represent the board adequately without calling in another counsel. What it does not address, and I think what we need to clarify here, is the planning board, zoning board, budget committee, who have legal lines with money appropriated in them for the budget committee, say, to expend. That's different from Attorney Gerald having a conflict so that he can continue representing the Board of Selectmen but not represent another party in town that deserves representation, but they haven't got the money in their budget. Is there any way we can clarify that by state law, by advice in Concord? Is there any way we can figure out if, A, say, the budget committee, which is our focus, if the budget committee actually has a legal line in its budget with funding included, are they then at liberty to spend that money on something that they deem appropriate with a legal vote without going to the selectmen?
I think the state law is clear that the hiring of counsel is the function of the governing body, regardless of what, under what line it's budgeted for.
Okay.
That's true for the library. It's true for selectmen.
So the library can't spend. The library doesn't have to go to the Board of Selectmen.
Right. Their governing body are the trustees.
Right. So in this, do you have an RSA reference? Because I just like to chat.
It's the case law notes under the Selectmen's Authority to Govern Prudential Affairs. And you can check Attorney Laughlin's treatise on municipal law and taxation.
Okay, great. That would be helpful. I just happened to have that question after reading that in the minutes, and it just didn't seem to address the authority of, say, the Budget Committee. If I then may make a request to the board to allow us, since we are under contract with Attorney Gould, and there was a misunderstanding there. Fred didn't put his hand up fast enough to holler at us when we made the vote on the 20th. So we have apparently inadvertently caused a problem here. If we may ask you this evening to vote to authorize us to spend the money in the 2016 budget for legal services so that we can satisfy our obligation to Attorney Gould. And we did vote publicly on the 20th of December to authorize the chair to hire counsel.
Questions?
I defer.
Dana, okay. I have a question. One, I don't remember voting on December 20th budget committee meeting, giving the chairperson of the budget committee permission to hire a legal counsel. The motion that was made, I don't know, Mark, if you could help me out, was not specifically said.
The minutes have not come out. It's been transcribed from the tape. It says, Mr. Pierce, make a motion, if you would please, along this line. Would ask the Budget Committee to instruct the Chairman to retain an appropriate lawyer to assist the Budget Committee in legal matters concerning its legal duties and obligations, and have the lawyer attend a meeting of the Budget Committee to answer questions and gain approval of the hiring of the lawyer. That's the verbatim.
And this stemmed from the Board of Selectmen's request of the Budget Committee for 91A in regards to...
Right. Yeah.
Right. So the Budget Committee is asking the Board of Selectmen for permission to hire a third lawyer to state the answer that has already been given them by Town Council and also by the attorney at New Hampshire Municipal Association. And my second question, Mark, would be, since the only authority comes from the governing body to hire counsel, would the contract with Attorney Gould be considered binding?
No.
Thank you.
Is there a motion on the floor?
No.
I'd like to make a motion, and I'd like to speak to it.
Well, we're in the question period right now.
But
can you make a motion?
He can make a motion.
Okay, and I'd like to speak to it afterwards. I'd like to make a motion that we rescind the 91A request.
You asked for a second.
I'll second it so that we can, for discussion.
Thank you. Number one, some members have already complied with the request. We have the emails. The emails have been
looked at by Attorney Gerald, and they've been looked at by the NMHA. They have been deemed to be illegal meetings. That's out there for the public to see. There was one email that was responded to by a member of the Budget Committee to the, so absolutely illegal. It was said at the meeting the other night that he was a new member, therefore let it slide. That's not the case. When I was a teenager, I was told that ignorance of the law doesn't help. You got to know what's going on. So if you're on a committee, you have to know what's going on. The Budget Committee is almost finished. I think that them spending $2,000 on an attorney is a waste of money. I think it's a waste of the town attorney's time. I think it's a waste of the energy of the town manager to go through with this. And I think it's out there. The public can look at it. The public can go back, can look at the meetings that are absolutely chaotic, can see what goes on with that committee. And I think we're there. I think we're just wasting money, taxpayer money. We're wasting energy and time that can be spent on infrastructure issues, can be spent on police issues, can be spent on fire issues, can be spent on a lot more serious issues. And I think, I invite people to go back and look at the meetings, at those meetings on tape. Look how they went after the manager on a trash issue that was a Warren article a couple years ago was passed. Went after the attorney because they didn't feel like he was his budget because it wasn't going for them, that he was going all for the selectmen. Look what he's done here tonight talking about the different issues up in the legislative. He's for the town. I think we're wasting our time. We're wasting our energy. I think people can see what goes on, and that's my motion.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mark, the first paragraph that the motion to hire an attorney from the minutes, and the minutes have not officially been published.
Not that I've seen.
When is the date of the meeting that we're talking about that requested this?
December 20.
Okay, so that's going on 3 weeks. How long does it take you to get minutes out, and why are they so late?
We tend to have complicated meetings, and Barbara is doing the best she can.
When are our minutes out? Are they out 3 weeks later?
No, they're usually out before the end of the week.
End of the week, okay. Right. You're the Budget Committee, Chairman Wolsey.
Right.
It's a $26 million budget. There are legal contracts. People need to be informed. You're failing in your leadership responsibilities, okay, in that matter. The public's not informed. I sat with you on this board, and I know the integrity of the interest that you purport to have for people, and you're violating that trust by not providing minutes. You, in this motion to secure funding, specifically addressed the 91A. Is that correct?
It was a direct response to counsel's letter to
Mark,
us.
Mark, will you read the first paragraph that Mr. Pierce's motion refers to?
Mr. Pierce makes a motion, if you would please, along this line. And above that, Chairman Woolsey says, Budget Committee members received letter last week on Friday from the Town Council requesting information from Budget Committee under Rights No Law, and the Budget Committee response is as follows. And then there was a letter read to the Board of Selectmen.
Okay. There has been a formal request. Jim, I believe you made the motion for the 91A. Is that correct? Okay. The board voted how on that? Is it unanimous?
I believe it was.
I believe it was, too. Your initial motion for 91 Alpha for the Budget Committee. Was it unanimous?
That was my motion? And
yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, Jim, it was.
Okay.
I believe it was unanimous. Okay. The town, by outside sources, by taxpayers, is routinely besieged, if you will, by 91A requests. And that's the fundamental right of citizens mm-hmm. to gain information. Your board has probably produced those. You've produced those. You've sued the Board of Selectmen. You've gone to court. You've gone to state agencies on your own. Okay? Jim talks about when you were a selectman. Talks about the chaos and the mayhem. We're not getting minutes. We're requesting legal fees to pay an attorney. You did not, according to the liaison to your committee, Selectman Barnes, have the vote to actually enter into that contract.
Yes, and the letter that was signed by the committee, I was not allowed to see because I would not sign it.
Okay.
That's what I heard when I
read the board's chair. The board's liaison is being kept in the dark. I have the floor.
You did not.
I have the floor. The negotiations that you entered in with Mr. Gould, you as a budget committee member, you as a selectman, you would, and I know this from having served with you, if there was a town department head, and you talk about encumbrances, that wanted to backdate a legal contract and go back to the last year and request a contract and spend taxpayer money for that, you would be Mary Louise Woolsey with them, and you would not tolerate for a second. You have provided documents to the town, or they have been provided, that you have an attorney saying he's redrafted your request to backdate from 2017 to 2016 a request for taxpayer funds. That is not allowed in this town. That is unethical. That's unprofessional. And it's not done. We don't go back and do backdated contracts. And I disagree with comments tonight that this is not important. This is the fundamental integrity of the town. You are the chair, the appointed chair of the budget committee. There are union contracts. There are men and women working out there. They're looking for pay raises and union contracts, ratifications. There's important infrastructure. You're holding illegal meetings. You held illegal meetings when you were a selectman. I had your email blocked. Mr. Welch, is that correct?
That's correct, sir.
And you were holding illegal meetings and continuing your discussions as a selectman. I had you blocked because I wanted no part of it. I informed the town manager. I informed the chair because I'm not going to play that game. I'm not going to be part of it. And that's what you're doing as a selectman. You continue to do it now. There is a 91A request for the information concerned with all your communication with that law firm so we can see what happened and how the chairman of the budget committee in this town is requesting to backdate an obligation to the town, and I have the floor, to go back in 2017 and ask to have a contract redated to go to the prior year's appropriation. Unacceptable. Unacceptable. Unethical. Not done. Period. There will be a 91A. Is there a 91A for that right now?
Not yet.
Not yet. That will be coming for your communications in totality with this law firm in Concord. That law firm in Concord charges $275 an hour?
Correct.
$275 an hour for you to deny the board, the governing body, or any citizen, request for information as guaranteed by state law to fight that. It's an open-ended contract that he will bill you how much later on subsequently?
His contract currently reads that there would be a $2,000 retainer charged against monthly, needing to be replenished to the extent it's billed against.
So it sounds like an open-ended contract that you're going to spend and squander taxpayer money on a backdated purchase order, if you will, on behalf of the town of Hampton, and it's a can of worms. And it's a standard that will not be tolerated by this board, and I'm confident that the board will vote in the majority to continue to unearth this type of malfeasance. And again, this is the budget committee in the town of Hampton. It's a $26 million corporation. It's the most important corporation in this town. Men and women and the chief is in the back of this room put their lives on the line. And you're playing games with this entire corporate structure. And it's a very, very low bar, Mary Louise, a very low bar. And the facts speak for themselves. The motion is that from this board, there was a motion, is that correct? At the last meeting, that this board will never sign and authorize the town manager nor the finance director to fund legal opposition to a 91A, ever. Is that correct?
That's what you voted.
Was that vote unanimous?
Yes.
3-1.
No, well, 3-1.
Yes.
3-1? It's 3-1 that nobody that is requesting information from the town will ever be allowed to take taxpayer money and deny a citizen the request for information that they're seeking, including you, Mary Louise. So that's on the plate. So that's not going to happen for you or anybody else in this town. And we're going to look into your conversations with that law firm up in Concord and backdating a contract to try and have the town and taxpayers fund your expedition to fight what is a constitutional right in this country. So that's where we're at, because I don't know what the legal issues are, but those are the very specifics of this issue. Those are the very specifics. I'm not done. I still have the floor. So that's the low standard that you have brought to this. There is a warrant article out to do away with the budget committee. Last year it was to reduce the number of people on the board. Did that motion pass? Did that warrant article pass? Mm-hmm. Now, in large part, due to your leadership, there's a warrant article to abolish the budget committee because of your behavior and your conduct and your low bar of ethics. your very low bar of ethics, and you come here and have the audacity tonight and mask it under something else other than what it really is. So I don't support your discussion here tonight. I don't support a motion that obfuscates and blinds the public to the transparency and the constitutional right they have for information. And this board voted on it, and this board, as far as I'm concerned, is going to continue with that request for a 91A and get the information that it voted in the majority for. And there will be a subsequent motion coming for us and a subsequent 91A for your information with this law firm in Concord. And we're going to get to the bottom of this. We're going to get to the details of you trying to renegotiate a contract in 2017 to go back to 2016. We're going to get to the bottom of that. And there was a motion that was passed that this board will never authorize the finance director or the town manager to fund with taxpayer money a constitutional right for free information in the United States of America in the town of Hampton in the state of New Hampshire. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I'd just like to follow up that I agree pretty much with what you're saying, but the only thing is we already know what's out there. We know what took place. We have that information. I don't think, I just think, what's the gain? What are we going to gain more from what we gained already? It's known that it was illegal meetings. It was illegal correspondence. There was response to it. So now we go and we keep pushing it and pushing it and pushing it. And what's the final gain?
We aren't pushing anything, I would say.
We're asking for 91A.
It was your motion. It was supported.
I still have the floor. I still have the floor.
Oh, pardon me. I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I think at this point, though, what are we going to gain from it? I want to know what the outcome is. You know, we're putting a lot of effort into it.
Okay.
What is
the gain? I'll answer that question. This is the town of Hampton, and these are constitutional rights of people. And this is a duly elected board, and this is the governing body. We're going to set the high bar, and we're going to etch this in stone. So none of this malfeasance ever occurs again. And people can't have private meetings in the United States of America, in the town of Hampton, on a $26 million budget. And this is just the emails, Jim. This doesn't speak to the telephone conversations. That would be a whole nother can of worms, okay? They're holding private meetings. This isn't a third world country. This isn't somebody without a constitution. That's the purpose of it. And I'm not expending any energy on this because I know what's going on because I've served with Mary Louise Woolsey before. And I've been subject to the same kind of shenanigans, the exact same kind of shenanigans. And we're going to set the bar, and we're going to put the spotlight on it, and it's not going to be a mushroom growing in the dark, and nobody is going to have a private meeting for the Budget Committee, the Selectmen's meeting, the Cemetery Commission, or any commission in this town. And when we vote on something, we vote on it, and we're going through with it. And I hear Mr. Welch didn't respond quick enough. I hear in 2012 Mr. Gerald said this and said that. No, the issue is this young lady's conduct. It's her lack of ethics. And it's her chaotic, as you describe it, lack of leadership of that Budget Committee. And it's why it was reduced last year. And it's why it may well get thrown off the wrench this year with the Warren article. And these aren't lunatics that are signing this petition to remove it. These are business owners and taxpayers. So my answer to you is we take the high bar. You made the motion. We support it. We etch this in stone. And nobody violates the rights of citizens in this town and taxpayers. And nobody hides with a shadow government. And we set the bar high on it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Can I call a vote on my motion?
Okay, we have a motion. We'll second it to drop the 91A
request.
Rescind
the 91A, yeah.
Okay, all those in favor? Those opposed?
Okay.
Okay. So.
May I?
Yep.
Respond?
Sure.
Thank you. Mr. Welch was present at our meeting on December 20th, heard the motion, and it would have helped, perhaps. You put your hand up pretty quickly on the fifth, Fred, and I acknowledged you right away. You could have at least said, all of you need to understand that you need to come to the Board of Selectmen in order to do this. That it would have helped. I don't go out and hire attorneys every day. I thought I was doing what I was directed to do by my board. Number two, and that was a public vote. Number two, that was holiday time, as you all know. We had Christmas and New Year's. I was trying very hard to find counsel
before the end of the year, with all of the holiday mess, and it certainly not easy, in order to have the 2016 budget funds available for the Budget Committee. I signed the letter of engagement, which was emailed to me on December 29th, 2016. The retainer document was not included. That wasn't my fault. I don't work for the law firm. When it came the first of the following week, it came with the first of the following week's date on it, which was January 3rd, 2017. I called and said, we need, you know, I signed the engagement letter in 2016, and so we need to have the dates coordinated. I believe Mark has already spoken with Attorney Gould about that. I wasn't asking anybody to change anything. I had signed and scanned and mailed the engagement document in 2016. I'm not a lawyer. I'm not a magician. I tried my best to do what I was instructed to do by the Budget Committee in a public vote. I don't quite understand the 91A uproar. I took over the chair of the Budget Committee in September. It took a little while to get organized. When Mr. Nick Bridle left, he did leave a couple of notes of things that were left hanging, and I read that. And he did say that he has secured the calendar for the Budget Committee for the coming work sessions. I went to Christina, who knows everything, and I checked with her. Sure enough, the dates for the Budget Committee hearings and work sessions were noted properly on the calendar. I wrote them all down so I could produce a sheet telling people what dates we would be meeting, and that worked well. By the time we got into the end of October, it was obvious that the 2017 budget figures were not going to be available to us in a timely manner. The meeting schedule for the Budget Committee is posted and has been posted. On the meeting schedule since late summer, whenever Nick went over it, I agreed with what he did. It was all set. That was there for anybody to see. In my lifetime, the calendar hasn't changed. You have January, February, March, etc. And I think every board of selectmen and every manager understands when it is appropriate to produce the next year's requested budget figures for the Budget Committee to review. I did not get the notice from Christie that the Budget Committee books were ready until November 4th. We missed the 27th, the 1st.
Point of order, Mr. Chairman. Mm-hmm. There was documentation put out by the finance director on when budgets were produced. So we heard that it wasn't timely, but Mr. Welch, could you share the information on that?
Generally, within a general sense, to answer your question, we were roughly within 1 week of where we've been the last 4 years.
Okay. I just like we're hearing that things aren't
timely. 1 week of completing the budget.
We're hearing things aren't timely. Ms. Woolsey, you are a strong advocate of your own career in town politics and how long you've served with the Budget Committee. And you have no expertise in 91As, you have no expertise with lawyers, but you sued the Board of Selectmen. This is, again, a point of order because I want to rebut this before I forget it all. I'm not taking notes. Suddenly you're a novice. And you like to espouse when you run in all of your elections just how many years you've been on the Budget Committee, how many times you've been a selectman, and suddenly you're incompetent. That's what you're telling us tonight. And suddenly it's Mr. Welch's fault. Suddenly it's Mr. Giral's fault. Suddenly you don't know what you're doing. And that's obvious. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
May I continue?
Yes.
I went back 10 years, as I publicly stated, and found that the Budget Committee meeting, initial meeting, to review the budget request was between the 26th and the 30th of October. The last 10 years, I didn't try going back 40 years, but I thought 10 years was indicative. The first meeting of the Municipal Budget Committee to review the next year's budget request took place in the last week of October, period. The schedule was clearly online on meeting that you can see before the Budget Committee sits down to review your budget request, they need at least a couple of days to review the documents.
I have a point of order.
I'm trying.
Are we discussing timely fashion of getting the budget, or are we discussing
legal issues?
Legal issues. We're off the subject right now. It has nothing to do with what emails that went back and forth. That's not what we're discussing.
The Budget Committee needs at least a couple of days to review what this year turned out to be a $27 million budget request. So there's a time factor there.
Again, point of order, the agenda says legal issues. How is that a legal issue? We have a liaison.
And the budget was a 0.9% increase from last year. It was $26.8 million roughly this year.
$26.8 million is $27 million.
Mr. Chairman,
may I please, since I have listened to, too bad.
Legal issues,
I had
please.
Can we try to stick to the legal issue part?
I understand that, but this is related. I had to revise the Budget Committee work schedule probably 6 to 8 times. And every time I did that, I sent an attachment. I sent an attachment to the members of the Budget Committee. I have 12 members of the committee who need to know when meetings are scheduled and what they're for. What do you want me to do? You're babbling about 91A.
Mr. Chairman.
Should I? No.
No, I want to.
Should I?
Seriously?
Should I call 12 members of the Budget Committee and read the schedule to them?
Point of order,
should
Mr.
I
Chairman.
I'm okay. Not.
Mr. Chairman, Mary Louise, we don't have an issue with those emails. Those are not the emails we are referring to.
Well, then somebody could.
There are other ones, and you are well aware of what they are.
Well, I'm not aware of what they are.
Any email, as you should be aware, when you send them out for a notification of a meeting,
mm-hmm.
you've got every right to do that. It's when there start to be some extra ad-libbing in there. That's the problem. You open up the opportunity to allow people to interject, or you interject yourself. That's what's not allowed in that. Sending out the agenda, sending out any of that, that's fine. It's when you start to add more stuff to it, that's when there becomes a problem, and that's what the 91A issue is basically about.
Well, I would like to see what I know that I did get a little excited when people were pouncing on me that one weekend in December, all hollering about pay raises. And I did send, I acknowledge that, and I forwarded that to you. I acknowledge that I wasn't advocating anything, and the collective bargaining hadn't come up. That was probably not a smart thing to do. But otherwise, I think I have sent emails to Regina saying, where is the IT report? I asked by email if you could post the collective bargaining agreements online, and they finally are online, and we appreciate that, because if we can read those things, that
Chairman,
helps.
Chairman, point of order again. These are not legal
issues.
I would
like to
Mr.
know
Chairman,
what...
Chairman, I may have the floor, please, as a point of order.
No.
Point of order.
This is
right.
A point of order. The agenda item is legal issues. We're getting a reiteration of the inconsequential minutia in self-defense of Madam Woolsey. Mary Louise, Mr. Buckley from the New Hampshire Municipal Association, that we pay $17,000 a year emphatically states, and he's an attorney at law, that you and your committee have violated state law under 91A. Mr. Gerald states that you have violated 91A. I have read this. I have read your correspondence as a selectman and had your email access blocked while you were a selectman. You did the same thing. We are talking here tonight, Mr. Chairman, about legal issues. We can go on and listen to this, but what is the other issue besides 91A? It says issues. Is there another legal issue?
No, that's it.
The hiring of outside counsel.
But that's related to 91A.
Okay, and is that an issue tonight, hiring of outside counsel for the Budget Committee? Is that the other issue?
Well, I would say it is, because I did what I was directed to do by the Budget Committee, and we've ended up in a tangle here.
I got it.
And at the time the vote was taken, I think it would have been helpful, talking about communications, if Mr. Welch had said just the brief comment, you need to run this by the
Point of order again, Mr. Chairman. We've heard Mr. Welch been thrown under the bus. This is the third time. This is not Mr. Welch's responsibility. For a tenured statesperson in the town is you, Mary Louise. There has been a vote that the Board of Selectmen will never authorize the expenditure of taxpayer funds to oppose a 91A request. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. That's the second legal issue. That's off the table. You're not going to get it. So is there another legal issue? We've addressed both of those.
Well, how did you expect us to...
No, is there another legal issue, Mr. Chairman?
How did you expect us to respond as a committee to the 91A request that seemed rather overarching to us, and we needed to know specifically what was supposed to be done. And we are not attorneys, none of us. And that seemed a very broad-based request. And I can understand the motion that was made, I didn't make it, to hire counsel. Now we have an attorney inadvertently caught in the middle of a controversy here, because this is not Attorney Gould's fault. And on a personal level and a Budget Committee level, I would like to see a listing of the horrible emails that you are concerned with, because I would like to understand.
Well, point of order, Mr. Chairman, nobody's saying horrible.
First of all, we've only got a few of them.
Right.
From a couple of people.
Steve LaBranch said he forwarded 100 some.
I don't know. I don't believe it was 100.
Well,
however,
couple? Then what? I do not understand what we're talking about.
Because there are more than three members on the Budget Committee.
Yes.
And only three of them have responded.
But people are puzzled as to the response, which is why we wanted counsel, because it seemed such a broad-based request. First of all, I have Yahoo. And I don't know. I'm stupid with technology. I don't know how to go back 6 months or whatever it is to retrieve all the confounded stuff, like everybody else probably might. If you can give me examples, if you can give me a list, you don't have to do it now, but give me a list of identifying emails that are breaking the law. If I had put, and sometimes in the old days I'd put information only, do not respond. Is that appropriate to do? How do you handle a committee with 13 members, 12 of whom have to be updated and understand particularly the schedules, but also if Budget Committee made a request of Regina and we didn't hear back in a timely manner, I would have sent a request.
What is a timely manner? Because we got you what you wanted when it was the first became possible to get. But it hasn't come to the Board of Selectmen yet, it's not going to go to the Budget Committee. Neither is the budget. It wasn't done. That's why you didn't get it till November 14th.
Mr. Chairman, we can go on with this all night. There's a specific 91A request that has not been complied with by the chair nor the board, the Budget Committee. We have addressed two legal issues. We can talk about this all night. Now we're hearing that Madam Louise Woolsey has no computer expertise, where if you bring your laptop in to see Paul, he'll get exactly what you need from your computer.
Well,
so if we can bring this to a wrap-up, because we've identified two issues and I hear no others.
If you can identify for me where I have done something terrible with these emails that you've already got, I will appreciate that. A list, whatever, so we can see where the problem is. Number two.
Has Selectman Wolsey, point of order, provided emails to you?
Some have been sent last week. The question here is compliance with the request. It's not the significance of the document.
I understand.
But it's a broad request, counsel. Furthermore,
I have sent you the request as directed by the selection.
Yes, I understand
The legal issue is not what is the significance of the communications. The legal question is, should the request be complied with? As Mr. Bean pointed out the other day, that is not an adversarial request. It is a right-to-know law request that can be complied with. If there's an argument over the legal significance of what appears in the emails, then we can talk about that. But as yet, we've only gotten a few members' responses. If the board still wants these documents, then this should be complied with.
But I would like
it
to add something to what
counsel.
And it's not Mary Louise, it's not just you, it's the whole committee needs to comply with this.
Right.
You're not the only part of the problem, all right? Everyone needs to comply with the request that was approved by this board from the budget committee. That's it. There's nothing to argue about it. Hiring outside attorneys is ludicrous.
But the request seemed overly broad, and I think people had a hard time, including me, trying to understand what the focus is. If I send Regina, I try very hard for people to understand what I'm doing as the chairman. I don't want to be sneaking around as the chairman. If I'm changing dates, if I'm asking for information, I want every member of that committee to know precisely what's going on. I think that is the fair way, as the chairman, to conduct business. I think I have a little problem with what I feel is overly defining our 91A, but someone smarter than I am can figure that out. I went ahead at direction of my committee and hired counsel. We need to, at least out of respect for that poor lawyer, to resolve in some fashion what we do. It would probably take
point of
me,
order, Mr.
I don't
Mr.
know how
Chairman.
Long it would take to go back in and go
point of order.
Through.
We need to resolve for the point of the poor taxpayer that the board has voted that this will not be paid for. So I'm much more concerned about the poor taxpayer and a young lady or an elderly or citizen of this town that struggles to pay their taxes. And we've heard Mr. Silber to come in here and talk about how people are pressured because there's no Social Security increase. And Madam Wolsey would go out and spend in an open-ended contract thousands and thousands of dollars without a formal vote by the Budget Committee. We can talk about this all night long, but it's very clear. It's a very specific 91A request. Our position is that bill will never be paid. And again, I would ask that we terminate this discussion and we move on with the town's business.
We need to resolve, the attorney should not be made to suffer for whatever.
He hasn't done any work yet, Mr.
I don't
Mr.
care
Bridle.
About what the attorney
we,
does
well,
and doesn't
we have
do.
Gone ahead in good faith and hired an individual. I think Mark wouldn't like it if someone did that to him. But we need to figure out where we go from here. I don't know. I can't take a gun and force everybody on the budget committee to send in their emails. I guess you can hire firms to check people's email and come up with whatever it is you're looking for. I have a problem I don't know whether you can come in and find the emails that you're looking for. Because I have a devil of a time trying to go back. I went back and sent about six to Mark. I think I copied you guys on them. And it would take me forever to go backtracking through all the mess that I have of email.
And that's why, like today, the other day when you sent it to my home email, I asked you to please send it to my town
right.
email. That way there, it all comes through here, and that's the benefit of having a town email.
Right.
But I think the request was pretty specific. I think we asked for any correspondence that went back and forth.
My only correspondence, Rusty, as chairman of the budget committee, has been with Mark, with Fred, with Christy, with Christina, with Regina, asking for information or whatever. I'm not.
But we asked that of every member
and
of the budget committee.
You have copies of some of those.
We've asked every member of the budget committee, and we have not got those back.
But do you not have copies that I have sent to Regina? You know you have that. I copied the whole board of selectmen.
Yes, you just stated that. You're just one member of that board.
Well, I can't. I can't take a gun, Rusty.
Then
what can I do?
Can I just make a statement?
And I think it would have helped. But one second, Jim, bless your heart. I think it would have helped us tremendously, truly, Fred, because you have so much experience. If you had said to us, "Stop, halt, don't get yourself into trouble."
Point of order, Mr. Chairman. Enough of trying
really
to throw the town manager under the bus.
It's going to be a much bigger mess than we need to get into.
Mm-hmm.
We've got to have a resolution here.
We've had it. This meeting's over.
I know you've said that. I want to go on the record saying this is going to be a much bigger mess than we need to get into, and we should be able to resolve this, and it should be able to. Everybody knows that it was the illegal meeting, that it was, for whatever reason, I'm not going to question somebody's motives. All right? But it was done. We all know that. We're going to keep going and going and going. I mean, my motion was shot down, that's fine, but I just want to go on record saying we're getting into way too much of a mess than we need to get into.
And I totally agree with you. All we need to have is have everybody send us their emails, and we can move forward.
And I'd like to say it wasn't a mess for me. It wasn't a mess for Bob Ladd. It wasn't a mess for
Steve LaBranch.
And Mary Louise has sent in some of hers. So I don't understand why it should be a mess.
It's not
just
a mess.
Forward your emails to...
If I may, Mr. Chairman, just wrapping up, and Jim, there needs to be no further effort. Either members of the Budget Committee comply with New Hampshire law or they don't. And there needs to be no more effort on that. There's a Warren article that's coming up to abolish the Budget Committee. And if we have a lawless Budget Committee that's providing input, holding meetings illegally, then perhaps voters will make the right decision. But we don't need to hear how Mr. Welch didn't do his job. We've been down that road years ago, Mary Louise. We don't need to hear how Mark Giraud isn't doing his job. We don't need to hear about your ignorance and your incompetence. You're always boasting about your municipal excellence and your capabilities.
I'm talking about computers, Mr.
Beacon. I have the floor. And so it doesn't need to go any further. Either the Budget Committee complies with law or they don't. And there's a referendum on their very existence after being cut down last year, and there is no more effort on it. They either comply or they don't. Mr. Chairman, may I please request that we terminate this insanity now?
May I have one more?
I'm going to let Jim go ahead.
Rebuttal, thank you. The mess I'm talking about is I don't want to get into a mess. It's not with people giving their emails or not. I don't want to get into a legal mess of not somebody not being paid and the town owned. What to resolve? That's all, you know. So, and I agree, they either comply or they don't. But let's not get into any kind of a mess here that we're going to end up in court or something and wasting more money.
I don't know how you can force individuals to.
They are elected officials, and by being an elected or appointed official. They fall under certain requirements, and as you well know, as a 91A, they are supposed to buy that. Yes, sir.
May I suggest, Mr. Chairman, that if any of these members wish to receive assistance from the town on how to discover these emails and format them and print them out, and then they give them to the individuals, and they can send them in compliance with the requirements, that our IT staff be requested to assist in that manner.
So moved.
So you mean bring in the computer?
We could bring in our IT people to help. Okay, there are people
would
like
have to bring members would have to bring in their
either that or they can come to you.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Either one, they can either come to you or we can bring them in here.
Well, it's not going to do any good to come to me. I can't find anything.
Well, dismantling your computer is not necessary. They can come, you can open the computer up, and they can show you how to find it.
Okay.
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 Which would make it much easier.
I appreciate that. Now, what do I do with the Budget Committee regarding counsel?
Again, if you need counsel, obviously.
But we've already, my problem, Rusty, is pursuant to the Budget Committee's motion, I have engaged counsel. What do we do from here?
The Budget Committee's motion was not to engage counsel herself, but to bring that counsel to a meeting where the Budget Committee would explore hiring.
And I think if you go back and look at it, that's exactly what it says in the motion.
Madam Olson, you terminated a chair with the motion here in this town because you requested billing information for terminating the services of outside counsel that was very expensive for labor negotiations. You made that motion sitting right at this desk. You made that motion. It was seconded. Ben Moore quit.
Oh, I know that.
Mike came in and took the spot. Mm-hmm. You were all subsequently voted off the island. Mm-hmm. Okay? That's unheard of in this town. Unheard of. Okay? And the charges were spurious. They were again concocted. And I would probably say an illegal meeting occurred before you launched that missive. Now you are hiring outside counsel without the authority and begging here in this moment because you're worried about a conquered lawyer. You're not worried about the taxpayer. You have engaged counsel on your own, not with any official documents. And it's a two-sided argument that you have. I've grown sick of it. I have watched you for years in this town. You are a tornado of destruction. You continue tonight. And I would just ask that this stop. Either the Budget Committee complies with the law or they don't. It's that simple, Mr. Bridle. And we can end this right now.
Okay. So?
Well, there's no... There's no resolution.
Well, you can entertain a motion in response to the request that's being made to the board tonight to hire this counsel.
Which we already had a vote not to, but...
Right.
We did.
Anybody that wants to entertain that motion?
Well, I voted in the negative. I voted in the negative, bet, so correct. I cannot, can I?
We don't use Robert's Rules of Order.
We don't use Robert's. So. All right, I will make the motion to get past this and get it through. That the Budget Committee is allowed to use their line item for legal counsel, but not to backdate it to 2016, the 2017, and with a cap on it of $2,000. I'll make that motion.
Any second? I don't see a second, so motion fails. So.
End of discussion.
End of discussion, correct.
Well, what do we do? Where do we go from here? We were trying to resolve the 91A request by getting counsel for the Budget Committee in a timely manner so this wouldn't drag on.
I would suggest this, Mr. Chairman, again. This is just typical Mary Louise. This is your forte. Chaos and destruction. I would say this, that Mr. Gerald has offered his legal expertise. He is a town employee and impartial. Mr. Buckley, we pay the New Hampshire Municipal Association $17,000 a year. He has ascribed illegal nature to your committee and your correspondence. You can ask him again, and you can go through your liaison, and then you can call Mr. Buckley, and he can tell you how to do this. Is that correct, Mr. Bridle? That is the solution to your problem.
I have no intention.
And either you obey the law or you don't. And everybody on your committee, Steve LaBranche has obeyed the law. Other members have obeyed the law. And if others choose to be lawless, so be it.
I have no intention of calling Attorney Buckley, who A, was extremely insulting when I called him, and B, now that chairman of committees, including the Budget Committee, everyone under the five-person listing now cannot directly call the NHMA.
Unless you come to ask us, and I'm sure I would give you that permission to do so.
I believe it's just been suggested.
And it has been just suggested there that you call him. He has just suggested that you call Mr. Buckley.
And when I called Mr. Buckley, it was the most insulting phone call I have ever taken in
point
my life.
Point of order, Mr. Chairman, now our registered representative for the town has voted on that Mary Louise has authorized expenditures for during her last tenure is now being thrown under the bus. And I won't go for this character assassination. I've been subject to it from this woman. I'm not going to allow it to continue.
We've got to come to some type of resolution, which is why I came here this evening. I'm listening to what you're saying, and I'm sorry that we couldn't catch this before we ended up in this particular position.
And I think the resolution is
yes
that we've asked for a 91A request.
Yes.
We have not received it from some of the members.
Yes.
If that doesn't happen, then it doesn't happen. They're breaking the law. As a 91A request.
Okay. Well, could I at least ask for a brief listing or some type of information on what was found to be illegal from the emails you've received to this point in time? I know you had a concern over the email that I sent saying everybody's yelling about their taxes. Where are the other problems?
At some point.
If I could,
yes.
I would make a motion that Mr. Buckley's response that was maybe in a confidential status right now in his letter to the town attorney, perhaps to Madam Louise Woolsey, be posted to the town website.
I'd second it.
We have a motion. Motion and seconded. All those in favor?
Okay, haven't seen the letter, is it specific?
We will get you a copy of it.
Okay.
I will also ask Attorney Gerald to go through what he does have and take a look at it and give you some basis as to what
I need to understand
the items we're looking for, correct.
Right. Now, what do we do about outside counsel? It's got to be resolved. We can't just see her sucking our thumbs.
We've already said at this point in time we're not doing anything about the outside counsel. We said that in a vote the other day. That when it comes to a 91A issue, we are not going to support
any board,
whether it be our board or any board.
Or any employee.
Or any employee, yeah. There you go.
Well, we thank you, and I'm sure the members of the Budget Committee had an opportunity to watch this evening, and we will confer and see what happens. Thank you.
Thank you. The next is Town Manager's Report.
Mr. Chairman, members of the Board, excuse me. The Department of Public Works started Christmas tree collections today at curbside, or trees may be brought to the transfer station during normal business hours. Trees must not be wrapped in plastic, as some folks do upon occasion. Tree stands and all decorations must be removed or the trees will not be accepted. The street closure on Brad Street and Lock Road was the result of a collapsed metal culvert. The culvert rotted from the outside top inward, which collapsed the street. It has been replaced. I had originally written it was being replaced, but it has been replaced with a plastic insert. The department has started a program to begin replacing all of our metal culverts with plastic inserts where they cross streets. It may take a number of years to complete, but it is the start to correct a problem with cross street culverts. The state paid the town for its shared rooms and meals reimbursement $778,227 on December 22, 2016, which is about right. They try to get it to us as close to the 31st of December as they can. Please remember that the submission of petition warrant articles must be presented at the Selectman's office in the town offices by 5 p.m. tomorrow, January 10th, 2017. Again, I'll ask for people to please remove their trash and recycling carts from the street and sidewalks once your collection has been made. High winds last week created a number of problems with carts
that were blown into the roadways in the evening and were a danger to traffic. I have a couple of other things, Mr. Chairman. Excuse me. I think I'm coming down with a little cold here. I think we're sharing that all the way around for some reason at Town Hall. We had received a letter, a fairly lengthy document, from the Pittsburgh, New Hampshire Board of Selectmen regarding the control of local municipal roads and highways. It appears that as we go through this new electric line that's supposed to be coming through the state, that between the state and the federal government, they have determined that the selectmen of the towns have no control over their roadways where an electric utility wants to construct a power line with or without permission of the town. I'm not sure you want to respond to this. The Northern Pass situation is one that's been in constant flux for a long time, but they're literally through the New Hampshire State Site Evaluation Committee and several other agencies attempting to eliminate the selectmen's and the town's authority under RSA 231 so that, in fact, they can just do what they please without any permission at all from cities and towns. And I think you really ought to take a look at that. I did send it to you. I think you ought to take a look at it and determine what you need to do with it. Just an update on the Bicentennial Wall progress. You received the board received a lengthy report from our Deputy Director of Public Works on the 5th. They are progressing rapidly on placing the large stones against the wall. They're doing a good job. It's been inspected. We're constantly inspecting the work, and it's proceeding well. So hopefully that will continue. We received today an email, or I received it today, from our assessor concerning House Bill number 324, which would take the assessment of utilities from the town and place it in the Department of Revenue Administration. So we would no longer be allowed to assess utilities. Given the undervaluation of utilities during the last 2 years, we estimate, and that's all that this is, that we would lose, including our pilot program, based on the current 2016 assessed values of $100,069,000, we would lose up to $29,200,931 in potential revenues over a period of time. The assessed values would be reduced by $417,000. The $29 million figure is a projected figure over a number of years. The problem here is that if we look at the ratcheting effect of the assessed values, they go down each year under these proposals by the state. And I have notified all of our representatives and our senator has responded that he will examine what's going on with this, but I think it's an important piece of legislation. They continually are eroding the tax base of the town. There is a program before the legislature now to, in fact, do away with some of our assessing powers in the town, and the utilities is one of them. So I think you should keep a close eye on that. Thank you.
Regina, questions?
No, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Manager. No questions?
Yeah, I have a question on that Pittsfield letter. I read that. I read everything that
Pittsburgh.
Was in there. Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
I read everything that was in there, and I think we ought to support that. I mean, it has nothing to do with Northern Pass there. It has to do with who can control your local. Yeah,
right.
Local rule is absolutely the case. Do we need a motion for that, or just a consensus that we...
A consensus is fine. If you want us to do something about it, we'll certainly take action to do something about it.
I mean, I would take a, you know, we're always looking for people to help us and support us, and I would send a letter saying that we support them.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I would say it's the consensus of this board. Bill?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Welch.
Sir.
Selectman Waddell raised a good point about legislative efforts. We've all been in touch with the delegation, and your office has been apprised that we'll be meeting with the Speaker of the House in the Webster Room.
Yes.
Is that correct? And we'll be bringing up the chief, we'll be bringing up finance, we'll be bringing up the town attorney. We'll also have on board, Jim, Mr. Shurtleff, who is the minority leader, Mr. Hinch, who is the majority leader. And the town of Hampton has never been invited up there to have a sit-down. And we've spoken with the House Majority Leader before the delegation was sworn in. And he specifically stated that we need to look at Hampton's interests harder. And so Mr. Welch is preparing for that meeting with his executive. And I know Mr. Bridle's in on it, and now everybody is. But we're going to go up there, and we've talked about this for 4 or 5 years. And we're going to use the fine data that the chief of police brought up. Like this summer, 21% of his effort is on state. Right. So, Mr. Welch, if you just wanted to briefly for the public outline your concept of what that meeting looks like, using your command element, your department heads, with the minority leader, the majority leader, and the House Speaker, and the new Dred Commissioner, whoever he may be.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. We've been examining the legislation that's been filed recently with the state, the actions by the state of New Hampshire, and most of those actions are anti-town. I guess that's the way I've got to classify them, because they're actually taking money out of our coffers and forcing us to pay for state programs off of our property tax rate. And we're trying to identify that and trying to identify and quantify that so that we know exactly what's going on and why. The couple of items that were mentioned today, both in the meeting that was held with Representative Bean and some of our department heads, are just the beginning of the tip of the iceberg. And there's no question in my mind that we're talking about hundreds of millions of dollars of losses here for the town of Hampton and for other towns in the state as well. We had talked earlier about losses in the area of school funding because of the way the utilities are being billed and the legislature's ratcheting down the costs of the utilities. We're about to see that for the electric utilities. We just lost two-thirds of the value of our telephone utilities. We're about to do the same thing with the electric utilities. And, of course, the power plant, now that if the state takes this over, our agreement with the power plant is just gone. And they'll assess it. The last time I dealt with one of those was in another town, and the difference between the state and the town for the assessed valuation was $500 million. That's a substantial amount of money to stick on the taxpayers. So we're looking at all these different items that are going on constantly up there and the shifting that's going on constantly up there. And we're going to bring those items up so that the taxpayers know what's going on and the legislature knows what's going on. This phony business about, and I know Representative Bean has filed a bill about the cost of legislation that's filed. It took us minutes to get some of those costs together, and yet the state, the legislature, insists that those costs are indeterminate. They can't be determined. That simply means that they're not willing to determine them. We want to take that on. We want to make sure that we're right on what we're doing, and we are, and the other towns that we talked to want us to take it on. As far as the utilities are concerned, which I talked about today, we've notified both Seabrook and our representatives from Hampton, and we'll be notifying other towns, and we've already asked them for their input on what the value is that they're going to lose. So it looks like we're going to be putting together a consortium to help with those programs so that we will stop losing our tax dollars and our citizens can keep those monies in their pockets. And I think that's what we're going to talk
about. Wonderful. And, of course, the chairman's going to be in attendance. And Jim made a very good point. And, again, it's a team effort, and it's Rainey's going to be there, Mr. Shurtleff, and there's going to be no Democratic Republican thing. It's one team,
it's people,
one issue, in integrity-based legislation. Thank you, sir.
Okay. I went down and saw by Centennial Park. I've been down there 3 or 4 times, walking the dog, and they're doing a good job down there. They're really hauling a lot of stone in there. The cots you talk about blowing around. Also, not just for the blowing around, but the days we have the snow, I notice a number of cots, particularly on the Route 1 corridor. People are putting them, you know, you have a choice whether you put them in the road or you put them on the sidewalk. When it's going to snow, you really can't put them in the road because the plows are going to hit them.
Right.
They're going to get damaged. They're going to get knocked over. They really need to go up on the sidewalk, but as soon as they're empty, move them out of there.
And that prevents us from cleaning the sidewalks off as well.
Absolutely. So I know there's one building up just north of Town Square that puts theirs out, and they always put them right out in the street.
Yeah.
And the side of the road there is very narrow, and cars are always going out around them, and it's an accident waiting to happen right there.
If you look at some of the roads that we're plowing where the carts are left out, the plows actually have to swing out, and the road becomes so narrow at that point that it's difficult for two cars to maneuver.
Okay. All righty. Next is old business. We have the 2017 warrant articles. Finally getting to it. just go through the whole
We can, if you want, Mr. Chairman. There's certainly one that we've removed, which is the sidewalk warrant article. Let's see, article number 12 that's on this list. Obviously, these numbers are going to change. I don't know of any others that we need to change, quite frankly, unless the board wishes to withdraw any other articles that are on here. We do have some petition articles that have been received. I know today we received a petition article to remove the selectman's authority to set the default budget and vest it in the budget committee. So that's one article that was received. We received several articles with regards to, I believe there's two. I see one right off here, which is the 3533 Dover Avenue removal of deed restrictions. I believe there's one more that needs to be put in here.
We don't vote on those, right?
We don't.
You can. Statute says you may vote on any article. Last year you did, I think the year before you did.
On the petition articles we did?
On the petition articles, yeah. Take a look in the in the warrant just to make sure.
Why don't we take a look and see what we've done in the past? I don't see a problem with how this one was written. The lady that came in spoke earlier on Dover Ave.
She's still here.
Yeah. I know she's here.
Pardon me.
I know she's here, and so, like I said, when we come up to the deliberative session, that'll come up. It's not a money article, so we don't.
You can't. You don't have to.
We don't usually. We have in the past at time put a recommendation or a non-recommendation. And we're going to look and see how we've done over the past couple of years just to make sure. It's here right now. It's listed as Article 40. That can change. Are there any other articles?
I believe we have 43.
43 total now?
43 or 44. I have 43 in my hand, which is a request to remove a deed restriction on 11 O Street. So that's to allow a higher fence than 3 feet. I think it's a higher ornamental fence than 3 feet. And they want it as high as 6 feet. So that's a deed restriction. It has to go to town meeting for removal.
And any other ones that we need to talk about?
I think, Mr. Chairman, you've got a meeting that's posted for
tomorrow
at 5 o'clock.
5 o'clock,
where there will be the totality of the petitioned warrant articles will be known.
Okay,
the board could take up that question tomorrow as to whether or not to make a recommendation or not on any particular petitioned article.
We'll have a copy of last year's warrant there for your examination.
Very good. Okay, new business. Anything else in old business?
Yeah, I have one thing, Mr. Chairman. The finance director took a lot of time and effort to produce the actual increase, decrease, no change from last year to this year for the operating budget. And since that was disregarded by the budget committee, I would like permission to, after meeting with the finance director one more time, to put this up on the town website so that the public could have access to the information if they would like to see the actual changes from last year to this year in the budget.
Okay.
And as an extension of that, that it would be posted on the town website.
Yes.
All right. All we need is a
second.
Second. All those in favor? Unanimous. Anything else under old business? New business. We have the reappointment of the health officer and deputy health officer.
You have a form right here just statting around.
Okay.
Unless, of course, you're going to appoint somebody else.
So we have Kevin Schultz and Milton...
Mylon Marston.
There you go. All right.
I thought it looked like Milton, too, when I looked at it.
No, it's Mylon. So moved. All right.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Any other new business?
Mr. Chairman, if the board would move to go into a non-public session under RSA 91A:3, Roman 2, small c and d and e, reputation, acquisition of property, and litigation, before adjourning the public session. I'd appreciate that.
Make a motion.
Motion. Seconded by?
Yes.
Bill. Roll call.
Yeah, aye.
Unanimous. Okay. We're going to a non-public.